Hello and welcome to the Plant Paradigm Podcast, where we have inspiring conversations with amazing individuals from all around the world and look for ways to create a clean, green, and sustainable future for us, the planet, and all beings. I'm your host, Tom Simak, a fellow plant eater and athlete who strives to optimize every living ecosystem. Passionate about looking after this beautiful floating rock we call home and all the lovely creatures that dwell among it. Before we get into today's episode, I really wanted to take a moment to express my gratitude for all of you that have listened to these conversations and are listening right now. You're using your most valuable resource, which is time, to educate yourself on how we can tackle big issues like food waste, systematic oppression, climate change, antibiotic resistance, the list can go forever. That takes a real amazing individual to want to educate yourself about these topics that you can then take the information you learn and go into conversations and foster these really important connections where we can come up with solutions so that we can come out on the other side. If you do find these conversations valuable and you are listening on Apple and iTunes, please leave a review. And of course, I always love to mention, for the visually inclined, all these episodes do go up on YouTube. I am speaking to a camera right now at all times just to make sure that this information is widely spread. Speaking of YouTube, we're actually having a YouTuber on today, Mike the Vegan. A lot of you guys would know Mike as the person behind the camera saying really great puns, honestly. Like, for someone who's not a dad, he really has some home runs in that category. Mike is an amazing resource for those who haven't checked him out. I've been watching him for years, and with just under 400,000 subscribers on YouTube alone, there is a reason he gets the attention he does. Mike really sticks to evidence-based science through all categories, through nutrition, climate change, and even ethics. He dives deep into all these categories. He's incredibly intelligent, and I was really excited to have this conversation with someone I've been watching for years to dive into some topics that he might not have covered before, or for fans of his to see him in a different light. This conversation is very widespread. We're going to start with tiny homes, who doesn't love the modular things that are coming out and taking the world by storm as a trend. We're going to talk about agriculture, which is something that we actually don't talk about much on this show, but Mike is definitely an expert in that field. We're going to talk about some recent science, Andrew Huberman's butter comment, which happened a while ago, but as we recorded it, he had just said it. So I'll also link in the show notes his response to Andrew Huberman, which was great. We're going to talk about all things YouTube as well, the creative process of him making a video, and of course, science-based nutrition, including the big looming question: can a whole foods, plant-based diet reverse cardiovascular disease? It's something that I know is super topical and very, very polarizing in the field. Even vegans and people who follow a plant-based diet don't believe that it can reverse heart disease. But there is science there, and the argument is if it is good enough. So I was really excited to hear him talk about that from someone who has read the science and does know what's going on. With all that being said, I hope you enjoy this conversation between Mike and I, and I'll see you on the other side. I've made an effort to train myself not to say Mick, because for so many years I was saying that, like when I was watching your YouTube videos, and now I'm like, I've read your about on YouTube, and it's like, it's Mike, like Michael.
Yeah. Anybody who's from like Australia or the UK, Mick is just a way more common name in like the British diaspora or whatever it's called. And so here it's like Mike, like a microphone, hip hop, you know, like people mix it up a lot less, but I totally understand.
Do you like regret you using that kind of phraseology and not like Mike or Michael the Vegan?
Yeah, I mean, maybe a little bit, but then also I don't really care. Like, it's just how someone says something. People have different accents anyway. Like,
very true.
It's fine.
Well, yeah. Mike, welcome to the Plant Paradigm Podcast. How are
you
going?
Thank you. Glad to be here. Good. Yeah, a little scrambled. I was a little bit late, and I'm sorry because I was painting something and got distracted. I have my respirator marks on my face still, but
yeah,
you know, well, it's good stuff.
You got the explanation of the redness straight out the way.
Yeah, I'm actually, I think it's funny because I'm curious to see how long it takes to to fade. So everyone can just focus on that the entire time.
Yeah, absolutely. So you were painting a cabinet and...
Yeah, I made my own cabinets for a house I bought because I like to do DIY stuff. And so I've been painting them with like eco lacquer. And so I got like the respirator and the spray gun and all that stuff.
Well, I'm sure actually not a lot of people know, but you actually built a tiny home. Like mm-hmm. you're not just useful to stand in front of a camera and talk science. You actually do other things as well.
Oh, I love building things. Yeah, but that's kind of part of the whole like minimize your impact on the planet lifestyle. Like build a tiny house, eat healthy, don't be too crazy about your effect on the environment. Also just like building things. Like I said, I also have an electric motorcycle I'm mostly done with, which I'm excited about.
Oh, that's awesome. Wait, you're done? Yeah. You made it.
Almost. So I was an old 70s combustion engine motorcycle. I was like 400 cc Kawasaki. And I took all the combustion engine stuff off it. I mean, it was like a junk bike anyway, and sort of like rebuilt it a little bit, fixed the frame up, and got Nissan Leaf batteries that are old, which are electric car batteries. Yeah. And then I got a hub motor that I put in the back, spoked it in, and it's almost ready to go. Like I rode it once, but it needs some blinkers connected and stuff.
You realize you sound like a wizard. Like,
well, it's fun.
Is it like,
feels like it's magic.
So essentially like your partner's mom is living in your tiny house right now. Are you planning on afterwards living in that thing, having like solar connected to the house? You've got on this electric scooter, so you're like fully off the grid. Is that your plan?
Well, I'm planning on doing, because I just bought another house, planning on just making it all off the grid. So I'm going to looking at bulk buying some like slightly used solar panels. Like they have ones on eBay and other places by sellers that are pretty legit, where they have basically I don't know why they've decommissioned solar projects that aren't that old. So you can get like several kilowatts for like 25 cents a watt.
Crazy.
And off, you know, not too expensive if you buy enough. And so I'm just going to buy enough for both houses probably and hook it in. Then the things add up with like inverters and stuff, but you know, in time, it's not all overnight.
So this house that you've bought, it's going to be off the grid with like water and everything?
It's hooked into, I mean, I can do the rainwater and stuff, but the tiny house is already off grid with water.
Right.
And it's just like a house that's in a town. So it's hooked up to water, but it's got a decent sized roof. I mean, it's not a huge house, but yeah, I could probably put a cistern in and filter it and all that stuff. But yeah, in due time. I'm also living in an area where water's just not an issue. Like there's no water scarcity where I am in Iowa. And so I'm like, that's further down on the list, but it's still cool to have the tiny house off grid.
Are you going to have like the full veggie patch and fruit garden?
Oh yeah.
What have you?
I got it. I've already got a bunch of June berries or service berries. Got like six of those bushes we're going to put in. But I wish I had time to do that. We've done it more some years than others, but it's a lot of work.
Do you actually, I always love having this conversation because you know how, I think what's really awesome, this new thing that's happened where you grow like almost like microgreens, you have like a bit of an urban garden. Mm-hmm. Obviously in cities, you only have like your porch or your deck, whatever it is. And you can grow like maybe basil, maybe some cilantro, like whatever it is. Do you think there's genuinely a taste difference from growing it in your porch to buying it conventionally in a shopping center? That's primarily a mental thing because you grew it yourself.
That's funny. I know, because I would say it's not just in your head. For some things, it's more in your head than others, but there's something about something that's fresh picked as well. Like I bet if some of these farms, if you ate it fresh picked, but then there's also the idea that these large scale operations are just picking things before they're ripe a lot of the time so that they're kind of look ripeish when they land on the shelves. So that's annoying, but you can go and take, like if you've ever had like a red pepper or an orange pepper, directly like a bell pepper directly off, there's another name for that, starts with the capsicum? C, right? I don't know. Capsicum. Yeah. If you've ever had that directly off the plant, it is so sweet. You know, it's a fruit anyway, so it makes sense, but it's like incredibly different than these sort of like the color is correct in the store, but the actual flavor, the nutrient content is probably relatively comparable. That really has to do with how stressed the plant was, with how many antioxidants and stuff it created. But it's, and there's just a little bit of probably oxidative processes that go on, like oxidative, not stress, just oxidation that happens between the time it's picked and the time it gets to the shelf as well, versus just picking that, you know, like fresh basil, so just pungent. Pungent's maybe not the right word. So fragrant and I don't know, even just juicier.
Yeah.
But now sometimes they're good. Of like, they'll keep basil plants sort of in water you can buy, and then those taste pretty much as good. But I am all about eating fresh stuff. It's totally changed my perspective on vegetables.
Does that, like, how do you purchase fresh? Because I know with the majority of people, you kind of rely on a supermarket. Not everyone has the knowledge or the room to grow food. Like, how do you know what's fresh though? Do you have like a dog's nose when you're in a market? You pick up, do the knock on the watermelon. Like, what are you doing?
Yeah, I wish I ate like perfectly fresh and all this stuff. But for me, it's like the super fresh stuff is a treat, like at the farmer's market or grown. Or like, I have friends with gardens. My friend just bought us enough basil to make several things of pesto. And so what I did is I just like put it directly on my food. And now I feel like I have to have, like, I eat like a bite of fresh basil and a bite of whatever I'm eating. And I'm like, man, I feel like I need to have that all the time. But there's, between farmers, like the farmer's market trend is definitely picked up in certain areas. So you can just go and get that. And then there's seasonal stuff, especially in Iowa, where it just turns into a tundra for like 4 months straight. So it's hard to get that stuff. There's some people with greenhouses though, they grow. It's a good amount of stuff, but it's, yeah. I mean, I still have to go to the grocery store for most of my stuff and just rely on seasoning.
I'm curious to know whether you, because obviously when we're talking about the stress of the plant, I know David Sinclair talks a lot about that and Bushewitz talks a lot about that in terms of like the amount of polyphenols and resveratrol and things like that you can get in organic foods that maybe isn't as accessible with GMO. And then where my mind goes, and I talk about this a lot in my episode with Dr. Matthew Nagra, and I'm like, we can't feed the population with organic food with our current technology, apparently. What is your thought on?
I mean, small scale organic farming can feed the world easily. They've done, I believe a WHO or a UN. Yeah, there was a UN report, I believe, on that. I could link it to you about how they did the math on how much small scale farming could feed the world if we just converted over to that more.
Small scale farming, obviously, meaning like what?
Yeah, small scale organic farming.
Like literally.
So basically, instead of having massive combines and so forth and massive machinery, which you could still have like reasonable machinery in organic farming, but doing that, having way more farmers in terms of quantity, way more farms in terms of quantity, but not necessarily using more space than we are now, you could create more food, which makes sense because it's just in more intensive farming. Yeah. And you know, we could grow enough grain pretty easily, and then we get into the whole conversation of how all the grain's going to, a bunch of grain's going to animals anyway, up to half of the world's grain, again according to the UN. So there's definitely a lot of things that we could be doing better. But you heard that we couldn't do it.
I heard that we couldn't do it. I think it was actually a report by Ocean Robbins runs this summit, the Food Revolution Summit. I think I read in there that they rely kind of like not to be scared of GMOs because the opportunity that technology can offer to feed urban populations. I think it's like this 50-page document.
Well, sorry to interrupt, but I was going to say, you could say that because of the Green Revolution and synthetic fertilizer and stuff, like that's how our population boomed. But the idea is theoretically, with everything that we have now, the technology we have now, the efficiency we have now of farming, GMO or not, like you could do small scale GMO farming if you want. That's just not even part of the necessarily part of the equation in terms of if we just had different systems. And you know, because every crop is going to be vulnerable to some type of issue. So more diversity, the better, honestly.
Absolutely.
So if we have a bunch of different grains instead of just corn and soy and wheat, you know, add in things like millet and teff and on and on and on. So if one kind of gets a disease or whatever, has a blight, then you can, you know, make sure you still have enough to feed people. So GMOs, you could just consider that like another strain, whatever.
When you're saying like small scale farming, do you reckon that's only a plausible solution if we kind of start to move away, like inherently from animal products? Like it wouldn't be possible to organically do it, especially because, like you mentioned, in the US particularly, the UN said 80% of grains grown are going to livestock, with Brazil and Argentina similar rates. Like you wouldn't be able to grow that organically and still feed the human population.
Well, it depends on how you grow it organically. I mean, it depends on also how we step up our game, because if we really got like farm bots going to the next level, then all of a sudden herbicides aren't an issue anymore. You know, they just come in and they just pick out that stuff. That's like talking like techno fantasy future on and on. But I'm just of the belief that, you know, even just small scale diverse grain farming, potatoes, you know, starch, you know, basically we have to grow our starches, our proteins, and on and on. If you're looking at a vegan system, you know, just diverse plant growth, I believe it's totally doable in an organic system. And there's a bunch of different organic systems you could talk about. And you know, there's certain risks and not, but for example, Rodale's farming system trial, which I helped a little bit out in, I was there for like a week at the Rodale Institute, and they found that the yields were, you know, very basically the same. In fact, they yielded more in the organic system during drought and flood than the conventional system that they had there. So
Oh,
I think
why was
it's
that?
the I think it just had to do with soil. My soil's so crazy, my hair is, I love it.
You always talk about that in your videos too. Like my
Yeah, I
hair's just so
know.
crazy.
But it's just like I look at this now, it's fine. It's just sometimes it like slowly puffs up or like just flicks off into itself. I have really curly hair, so that's why. But basically the theory is when you're spraying things with chemicals, GMO or not, GMO or just normal conventional, the microbes in the soil aren't as abundant or diverse because, you know, for example, you know, fungi creates a lot of soil structure, holds soil structure. So the sponginess of the soil will be determined by that. And so you basically get more sponginess of the soil if you have less chemical sprayed, and therefore you have more just water resilience. So you can soak that up. And that, you know, imagine that organic versus conventional field. If one's able to store 1 million gallons of water in the sponginess, and the other one's tiled, so it has these tubes that just get drain all the water away, then which one's going to last better with drought or flood too? Because if you have a flood, that means you can, you know, if you have deeper roots or like a, again, the sponginess, it's all about the sponginess. And there's compaction issues with the way they spray stuff on, and you know, it's on and on. There's so many things about so many things about conventional farming. It's a trade-off because you get really efficient, you just go and spray a bunch of crap and don't need to worry about it. Your man hours is way down with conventional and GMO, but you lose out in other areas.
I wonder what the, 'cause I feel like what's becoming really vilified nowadays, and I think probably rightfully so, is monocropping and that whole genre of things. Everything I've looked at just demifies it, which is perfectly fine. It looks to be pretty bad for the environment. I wonder, like, if we're looking at the quality of soil between organic and GMO, if they monocropped both of them, I'm thinking based on what you're talking about, the organic one could just bounce back so much quicker as well.
Yeah, and it depends on what they're doing, because organic, people find a way to get things that are like not that are not so great in organic systems as well. So you'd have to see, you know, what type of organic system it was. But yeah, the soil quality is going to completely depend on a bunch of different factors, and you know, how much it's really fungi too, like how much fungi you can get in there, fungal food. But I'm all about doing, even if you feel like you need to like have that massive lane to drive equipment, of doing like rows, like you have like nitrogen fixing tree, like a black locust or something, and then corn, and then you have your mycorrhizal fungi, which actually can take the nitrogen and stuff from the roots of the nitrogen fixing tree and bring it over to the corn, and on and on. And because you can do, you know, where you're just throwing everything together, sort of like even like the Three Sisters, where they had corn and beans and squash, where they have one that's sort of an understory. But the way that we have our machinery now, we would probably just like crush that. So you could do it. You could do it that way. But I do believe if we just revolutionize machinery, like for example, you have just two areas where you have wheels, you accept compaction, and then you have like a giant sort of like cantilevered thing that you can harvest and plant and all that stuff. So you're not compacting the soil. 'Cause that's another reason, if you're driving large machinery over it, then you compact, you create that compaction layer, which kills microorganisms, and it creates basically, it's almost like cement where the water flies right off of that. And so if you can just think about that and do everything differently, like you could totally just redesign machinery to have polyculture and it can just kind of harvest in different ways, but it gets more complicated if you do stuff like that. But anyway, it's funny that we're just talking about agriculture. I will say, I would love to experiment growing some hemp, but it's probably not going to happen anytime soon.
Is it hard to grow it?
It's more like legally here. I believe you have to do a bunch of paperwork and applications, maybe be an organization to grow it in Iowa. There's other states where you can do it. It's just because it's related to cannabis or, you know, a Schedule I drug, which is so ridiculous. I mean, I've talked about my views on that before. But the idea is, you know, organic industrial hemp could do really well, especially in a place like Iowa where we have really good soil. I know somebody around tried to grow it and they just like didn't do enough farming and it just grew overgrown by weeds. You know, they didn't take care of it. Right. So there's one, I've only heard of failure around here, but I would love to see it make bioplastics and biofuel and fabrics, textiles, all that good stuff.
I was going to say, like, I talk about hemp a little bit, but not enough, but like, from my knowledge, and I found this out from interviewing someone, that in Australia, like in Tasmania, there's actually companies that build houses from hemp.
And, oh, hempcrete, yes.
And I've seen hempcrete before. And I'm thinking, looking at the science, and France has actually been doing this for years, like from the 1960s onwards. Like, I think like 10% of their houses were actually built from hempcrete, and they're essentially fireproof.
Yeah. Yeah. It's cool. And it is so funny how we've just sort of like erased. I believe this is, don't quote me on this, but I'm pretty sure the first American flag was on like made of hemp or something. Whoa. Like and then it's like, it's illegal to grow. And it's just completely ridiculous, but there's so much you can do with hemp, and the fact that we can't grow it is completely insane. But yeah, hempcrete problem is in an area like where we are, where the weather is insane. We have harsh rains and frost heave and all this stuff. Like the hempcrete wasn't covered properly on a building nearby, like a eco village near me. And it just like started crumbling. It also depends on like the quality of cement that you use and stuff like that. So, but let's just take a quick break for me to look up first American flag hemp. I need to know if this is because I always have to fact check myself. Yep. The first American flag made by Betsy Ross was made from industrial hemp.
So do you think that it's possible to, well, in Australia, I'm thinking the reason that hemp is lesser known is because a lot of the lobbying from the timber industry actually got rid of a lot of the subsidies and things like that could happen. But hemp is really something that could, like you said, it can create fiber, clothes, flags, apparently. Like, we would rely a lot. And from what I know as well, in Scotland, they actually grow quite a bit, which actually, I can't forget the actual stat, but I believe it sequesters more than a lot of other crops that can be grown in the regions.
Oh, for sure. I believe it. Yeah. Yeah, it sequesters a good amount of carbon. I don't think it's quite as high as trees.
No.
But it's probably higher than other things. It also depends on what you're doing with it. Like if you're tilling it immediately and you're not, if you're like burning the refuse on the field or whatever, I don't know. It's all about practices, but yeah, it's a good, I've heard it mentioned a lot for carbon sequestration. Anyway, you want to talk about diet?
You want to talk about diet?
I know. I love talking about anything. I just think it's funny that we've just hit like basically agriculture. Really.
Agriculture is so important though, because I talk about this a lot. I wonder what your perspective is when we talk about, obviously you're vegan. So you talk about the philosophy, the animal rights, even like the human rights involved within the industry. And then we've got this category, and that can be argued all day. And then we've got this category of nutrition, which, let's be honest, can also be argued all day because there's so many gray areas.
Oh, for sure.
But I find with environment, it's so black and white. You can't really argue that animal agriculture is good for the environment in any level if it's compared to plant agriculture. Specifically, non-monocrop plant agriculture in terms of land use, water use, CO2 emitted, methane emitted, like nothing compares. So I love talking about the environment, because when you're coming into a conversation with someone else and having those impactful conversations so we can drive away from animal agriculture, environments are a really safe bet, because no one can come to you with a valid argument about why they don't eat plants.
Well, you will get the occasional Alan Savory regenerative agriculture person, which they are really, they tend to be like so totally sold, completely sold. Like it doesn't matter what studies I show them, what concepts like soil carbon saturation, soil carbon saturation, where we've shown even in their own studies, it's like after 12-ish years, it's like done in the system where if there's any sequestration going on, and that's like the best case of the best case scenario, where they're often, you know, completely ignoring the real impact of methane, which is super powerful, especially over 10 or 20 years, way, way more powerful than CO2. I mean, we're talking like 80, I believe it's 86 times as powerful at 20 years, and then like 130 times as powerful at 10 years. And we care about what happens to the environment in 10 years. So between all of those things, and then how, if you ever look closely, they're always like either shipping grain on or like putting chicken manure on the fields, which is just a way of like basically taking the grain, putting it through a chicken, and then using it as an input that they're like, oh no, it's like a polyculture, which we love, which is what we're talking about is good. They like take these things that are good, and then they find a way to try and sell it. And that's coming, you know, top down as well. I mean, that's General Mills, which is a massive company. That's the angle they're trying to take with their Epic Provisions, which is that jerky that they're trying to greenwash. And I have a whole video about it. I have a whole video about pretty much everything, but the idea is you will get those people. Like, but most people, you're like, hey, it's great for the environment. Here's a chart of how much better plant milk is than other milk or whatever, whatever. And then you do have those little like anti-vegan memes of like, almond milk is the worst thing in the world. And then it's like, well, actually, you know, here it is compared to dairy. Dairy is just more water. And even in California, where we have that scarcity issue, you know, forages and other pasture crops or animal feed is using way more than pistachios and almonds combined. In California, makes 80% of the world's almonds. And, you know, just things like that are frustrating because they've heard a meme. They like the sound of it. It allows them to continue their habits and feel good about it, or like ignore the vegan who is saying stuff about the environment.
How good is confirmation bias?
Yeah, everyone's guilty, but that's where it gets extra bad. You know, when these little like pop science sort of like pro meat things or pro dairy things that people love to latch onto is really frustrating.
I'll probably put Savory's work in the same kind of realm as religion. Where it's faith-based.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I'll be so savage about it. It's just...
you can't
mess around with the environment, because I have moments where I'm getting a bit salty. Like, I'm okay most of the time, but I'm like, come on. Like, we don't have time to argue about this. Like, we need a change, like, now.
Yeah, and then make everybody feel good about eating the most, like, climate-dirty food that there is off some, like, hope that it could somehow be better, and then they fail to prove it. And then they always have, like, oh, but there's a study of this and this and this and this, and it's like, you always look, and it's like, this isn't what you promised. Like, what are you talking about? It's supposed to save the world and green the entire desert and all these things, and it's like, it's just not doing it. It's a way that you can charge more for cow parts because it's like greenwashed and people want to pay more money for the environment because they're guilty. But it's like, oh man,
do you watch like videos on YouTube and stuff that are opposite of your beliefs? Like, I'm not sure if you did a reaction, I know Earthling Ed did, but to this one video that said eating meat will save the planet or something like that.
I did that. Yeah. What I've learned. I just looked. Sometimes I'll just search vegan on YouTube, and that's still up there for one of the things you land on, and it has like 3.5 million views now. It's only been 3 months. Yeah, it's so frustrating. But thankfully, a lot of people who watch it can tell. They're like, this just doesn't add up. Like, you're one person, your one source is an animal science guy.
I know.
Which means he's the dairy directly from the meat industry, and it's like, okay, that seemed a little weird. And then a lot of people broke down his arguments, so that's good. I don't know though what the average person, like, are people eating more meat? Are those 3.5 million people on average eating more meat, actually thinking they're doing a good thing? I don't know. We don't know. We don't have numbers on things like that.
I have roasted the guy. I've actually watched some What I've Learned videos. I think he does some okay stuff, actually. His other stuff is okay, but I've roasted him on the show a few times on that one video because he compared beef to almonds, which is why I thought of it. And I'm like, I always say, who doesn't eat a freaking Big Mac and he's like, nah, I'm going to get an almond latte instead. Like, who?
Mm-hmm. That is pretty funny. Yeah, it's not A or B. But another one is they cited a ridiculous study that was, again, done by animal science people about how a vegan diet wouldn't make that much of a difference. And it was just torn apart in the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, you know, several official published responses being like, this is ridiculous, going through all the points of like, they basically, I believe they had everybody eating like a 4,000 or 5,000 calorie a day grain diet where they burn all of the extra biomass on farms, and like they just did everything they possibly could to crank up the amount of carbon emissions for the vegan scenario. It's like completely insane. And so people just read it.
That's crazy. Well,
but he still quoted it 3 months ago. Him and the animal scientist guy are still going around quoting that probably to this day.
They're not gonna let go. They've found something. They're latched on like a bloody koala to a tree.
That's a good analogy that I do not hear very often in the Midwest of the United States.
Well, do you want to talk about diet? It's a mammoth of a topic.
Yeah. Is there any particular areas where you're like, you have questions or ideas that you want to talk about?
Well,
or
you subscribe to a Whole Foods plant-based diet. Am I right in saying that?
Yeah. It was like as much for me, it's like the more whole food plant-based you can be, for most people is the better. Like, I still think it's a spectrum, but I always try to provide like whole, fully unprocessed recipes and stuff. And that's where we see just like the crazy results in the studies a lot of the times too, is people on a whole food. Cause obviously you can go and just eat vegan fast food now, literally pull up to Burger King,
crazy,
and pull up to every other one, but most of them now have some type of option you can eat. And so you can just douse everything in oil, eat 100% fried food and sugar and all that stuff. And so if you're trying to get some health improvement, yeah, that's the direction to go. If you're just doing it ethically, then that's a totally different goal. But I still just like, I just feel the best the more whole foods I eat. I talk about it again, how it's a spectrum where it's like, I'm personally not reversing any disease. So some of these processed foods do sneak in to my diet. Like, I do end up eating at restaurants and I do end up eating things like desserts. Cause I'm like, you know, I have my LDL cholesterol is like 50, which is absurdly low. I don't know what that is in the millimoles or whatever, but it's really low. Like the average American is well over 100.
Yeah, I think
the cutoff is like
to like 150 or something.
Yeah. You're trying to be, the mainstream thing is that optimal is under 100, but that's just like what people might be able to achieve eating an omnivorous diet, including animals in their diet. But you know, someone like Dr. Esselstyn will tell you 50 to 70 is the ideal range. I'm sorry, I don't have that in millimoles.
That's okay.
But you can go to the converter. There's converters online, whoever's watching this. And so that's how I roll. Yeah.
Do you think, I want to dive into something that confuses me a little bit, actually. And it's something that I know you've made a video on. I reckon I've watched it 3 times, which is only because I'm just like, what is going on? Because you've got these two groups, and I get that veganism and plant-based world is a big, it's a large amount of people now, and there's going to be people in there that disagree with each other. And I know a huge topic is, will a whole foods plant-based diet reverse heart disease?
Oh, getting onto this one.
Well,
this
is the one that's really, it's a big claim, because when we look at heart disease, the leading killer, if we can reverse it, holy moly, that's, I don't know how many years of life we can add to an average person, but that it's, you know, a fair bit. And
yeah,
like, where do you stand on that in a nut? Like, what is your thoughts?
Yeah, fine. Yeah. Basically, I'm of the belief that if you take like a zoom out holistic view of what heart disease is, which of course, like, every time I talk about this, it makes a certain group of people very angry, but that's okay. If you look at the whole picture and the studies of what happens on a plant-based diet, even, I mean, people that are eating like 99% vegan, which applies to people who would be eating fully vegan. So it's, you know, it's more or less interchangeable depending on which particular study and which particular claim you're making. But the idea is that we're able to get a way lower rate of adverse events. We're able to see people's artery function ridiculously improve. And I am of the belief that we're able to see scans reverse the severity. And that's where I end up talking about stenosis flow reserve, which is where they, you know, used those angiograms to map out how much a lesion is probably restricting blood flow. And they found a statistically significant reverse or lowering of that stenosis flow reserve, which is, in my opinion, reversal of the actual physical heart disease in the artery. Yes, I want to see better imaging. I would love to see a randomized control trial, putting people on a whole food vegan diet or whichever vegan diets people want to compare, and doing the full scans of the ultrasound within the artery and on and on and on. But I still believe that between the all the studies that we have showing that the actual state as a whole is being reserved and you can get in or is being reversed, and you can get into some gray areas and say, you know, what's symptom reversal versus actual disease reversal. And it's like, if you're having 60% less adverse events and you're seeing improvement, that's actually improvement from somebody's body improving on its own, and to a degree that is very meaningful, measured from several angles, then I view that as reversal. There are people who say we have to have advanced imaging randomized controlled trials showing actual plaque volume shrinkage. Otherwise, it's a no-go. And these, you know, these angiograms where you see it clear up, you know, that might just be a fluke. Someone might have been reading it wrong, or, you know, on and on. There's a bunch of different excuses people have for that. But I mean, I personally see these, you know, see angiograms over and over again, talk to cardiologists, and they believe it. I mean, you look at somebody, a lot of the argument also was what do these experts actually agree, which became a point of debate. But looking at somebody like Kim Williams, you know, he's co-authoring papers saying a plant-based diet reverses heart disease due to this entire paragraph of evidence that we have in the literature. And he's, you know, former president of the American College of Cardiology. And he wanted to play the, you know, he wanted to kind of play the fence a little bit and see where things landed during the actual debates. And he never gave his official opinion on this matter. But you've seen, I mean, he's in writing co-authored saying it reverses it. So it's hard, you know, it's hard. Because, and then we have, you know, Dr. Ornish and his colleagues who are cardiologists, you know, in The Lancet, hasn't been retracted. The title is, you know, it's talking about it reversing heart disease. So it comes down to, if you've never actually seen the reversal of a disease before, where do you actually pin the line at the definition? And that's a massive discussion and debate unto itself. So I think it's fair if someone wants to say, look, I don't believe it reverses heart disease until I see advanced imaging showing, you know, clinical, you know, randomized control trials past a certain degree of, you know, lower volume. But at the end of the day, even if you were able to lower volume, but you weren't able to lower inflammation or something like that, then you could just have a smaller lesion pop and boom anyway, or like maybe your plaques would be less stable. Like you could even argue that you could have some plaque shrinkage and not reversal. So you can, there's always an argument against reversal of anything, but for me, it's like, there's enough stuff for me to cautiously make the claim that it's possible. I don't think it's good to make the claim that it's expected, but I think it's legit to make the claim that it's something that is going to, you're going to be better off doing that diet than not, by a massive factor, and that is supported by a lot of data in my humble opinion. So that's how I roll, you know, artery function and on and on and on, all of these things.
Do you think amongst all that, cause it's like people like Ornish and Esselstyn that are running these studies, they clearly have a bias towards plant-based, and that doesn't by any means mean that the study is conducted badly, because it depends on the method. Are they using a third party? But do you think people are quite wary of the study because they're thinking these authors might have a confirmation bias?
Yeah, I think that's valid. That's definitely valid. That's why they have randomized, at least Ornish's studies were randomized controlled trials. So he would have less influence in those than somebody like Esselstyn, who has basically just looked at everybody he's treated over the years and said, here is these incredible results, which are ridiculously incredible. ridiculous. But it's also the notion that unless there's straight up fraud, there's nothing that has been shown to improve the state of heart disease that much, like then compared to Esselstyn's treatment. So, you know, it can't just be the exercise, you know, it can't, you know, no exercise has been shown to have these results, and on and on and on, like no meditation has. But there's also, it's seen in enough randomized control trials or various trials by different people where you can see artery function go up and on and on from enough places. I think that it's completely legitimate. I mean, you could say, like, I just don't want to, like, everyone's welcome to have their own opinion. Just say, hey, these people have something to gain from it. Ornish sells a book on it, and on and on, but it's still, it's in the Lancet, you know, Ornish's research is in the Lancet randomized control trial. It hasn't been retracted. It's a government paid for program, I believe, on Medicaid. It's covered by insurance. Like, insurance wouldn't cover it if it was just quackery. You know, I believe it's, was it Aetna or one of those big insurance like networks covers it. So they don't cover keto. You know, maybe somebody will convince them to try, but I mean, low carb diets, over and over again, the meta-analysis show we have about a 30% increased risk of all cause mortality. Keeps happening. And so, you know, again, not a randomized controlled trial because we're talking long term. That's still a meta-analysis of observational data. So that's pretty high quality over and over again. Multiple meta-analysis seems to land on 30% increased risk of dying during the course of the study. So
that's like there's some good 30% stuff happening. 30% is just huge. I have the keto argument every now and again, and it's usually revolving around YouTube comments. I don't know why, but people flock to there for keto arguments. And it's interesting because keto is something that is really frustrating, but also unique in which it's shown to not have fantastic benefits, especially when you compare it to a plant-based vegan, even with oil diet. But it seems to give people this weight loss, which is what the Western society or what almost society at large wants. So it's this like diet that's potentially shown to be harmful, but it's giving you the results that you want. Whereas a diet with, like if you're talking about whole foods, plant-based diet, you're always saying this will lose weight. But it's like, why do I need to eat whole foods, plant-based to lose weight when I can indulge in everything I want to eat, high fat foods, high animal proteins, if I can lose weight that way, you know?
Yeah, it's frustrating, especially because there's this thing that happens when you start eating low carb where it's not, you'll have weight loss, but it's not actually fat loss. So they'll look at the, you know, the studies where they feed people the exact same amount of calories and on, and they match for all these things. And then they do body scans and you can see right away that that initial weight loss is, you know, it's fat free mass. So like water weight and glycogen. So your body is actually storing with glycogen energy throughout your muscles. And that, I don't know the exact number of pounds per person, but that's a decent amount. And so you get this boom, initial feeling of weight loss of like, oh, I lost 3 pounds in 2 days or 5 pounds in 2 days. It's like, no, a pound of fat is 3,500 calories. Like you don't even burn that much in a day. Like, I'm sorry, you can't burn that much fat. So it creates actually a false sense of how much fat people are losing. And yeah, people can go on if they're able to maintain a calorie deficit under the box of a low carb diet, they're going to lose weight. As I say before, you know, leveraging that mortality risk and on and on and on. But it's just, in my opinion, way better to do it through, you know, eating fiber and naturally triggering your appetite mechanisms and on and on. And then you don't have that rebound as well, because you can actually continue to eat that way that people are having weight loss on a plant-based diet. But if you eat this like super restrictive low carb diet that has you going insane and, you know, makes you angry because a lot of people just really don't feel good on that diet as well, as they're might be losing some weight. And then so that means they can't stay on it. It is a diet in the sense that it's like a short term thing they go on and then they come off it and then they rebound. So a lot of the studies really don't show benefits. So like a year out. So it's like, yeah, if you want to, if it helps you starve yourself over a few months, yes, you're going to lose some fat. But it's probably going to come back because you didn't really change the way you eat normally. But if you're able to just eat more plant foods, I mean, there's a reason that vegans in the US from the Adventist study, at least average normal BMI, and they were the only diet group to do that. They're just naturally eating a way that has enough fiber to trigger natural appetite mechanisms, really.
You know what's so funny about that as well? If you look at keto groups, they, well, in the comments that I get, it's always like, I'm built to last on fat, so I can work out better and I can do this better. Like, we're made for this. We're made to eat 80% fat. And a study that I, or a paper I have saved in my notes section, is this one by, it was published on PNAS, and I know you did a video on it, on the actual, I think it was an anthropology study where they looked at how the brain developed when consuming glycogen.
Consuming glucose.
Glucose, sorry, yeah.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that?
Yeah. Basically, it's my belief, and I think that I would like to see more data on it, and more people actually look at it. But and it's what they say directly in some of these studies by, you know, Karen Hardy and others, where they believe a large portion of our brain evolution and size of our brain over time was due to having a source of starch that was very consistent, and that was cooked starch and meat. Yeah, might have played. I always like to say meat could have played a role more like nuts, in that it probably, you know, was a certain amount of calories, but meat, especially in the beginning, was very hard. Again, very hard to procure in the beginning. We didn't really have a way to keep it, and there were so many other things wrong with it. It was dangerous for us to eat. It literally, like, get sick and die from all of the pathogens in it, and on and on and on. There's a lot of reasons, like I say, that a lion isn't the smartest animal right now. Like, we're not lions talking to each other on Zoom, who are the apex predator of all, you know, apex predators. Although I guess once we got more tools, we became better predators than them. But one thing that is becoming more and more clear, especially when we're looking at, like, looking at fossilized dental plaques and on, is that when we got access to starch, especially cooked starch, we gained access to a source of calories, consistent brain food that no other animal had access to. And that's something, you know, we're talking about underground storage organs, these plants that are just basically keeping these things almost like refrigerated, functionally refrigerated for us underground, that most other animals cannot eat. And then we can just go and pick them and cook them. And that is an amazing brain food, as opposed to, again, you have these animals who are fat and protein. Protein is a horrible energy source that we use only in, like, severe emergencies. And then that fat needs to be converted, or you'd have to be in ketosis, which is, people love to romanticize saying, like, oh, we were just running around in ketosis, blurdy, blurdy, blur. But that's not what it grew our brain. Our brain prefers glucose because it evolved with glucose. If it evolved with ketones, it would be burning ketones over glucose, and on and on and on. So it's pretty clear that we're, you know, in a normal diet that our ancestors were eating, like, not being in ketosis, we would need all of those carbs to keep going. Our brain burns about 20% of our energy through sugar, through that glucose. And so that starch is just chains of glucose. And we've evolved, you know, more salivary amylase and our pancreatic amylase, which just cleaves that amylose or that starch into glucose. And then we can eat that and get, you know, fuel ourselves super well.
I mean, you mentioned the brain is kind of evolved to want glucose over these ketone bodies. And I hear, and I heard it said by, I think it was Andrew Huberman, who has the Huberman Lab.
Oh, Huberman. Oh, everyone keeps telling me they keep hearing nutritional crap from Andrew Huberman.
Yeah,
oh.
I keep getting messages on Instagram saying that he should stick within his own lane. And to be fair, when it
comes- That's so funny. Oh my God, I have a text literally from a few days. let me get back and read this to you. This is so hilarious, dude. Sorry to interrupt this, but. Stay in your lane, Hubie. Literally talking about the exact same thing. That is so funny.
Because he's incredibly smart. I'll say it for the record. When I drill these, like, they, when it comes to the brain and specifically, like, neural pathways and that whole kind of zone, he's great when it comes to things like muscle memory and describing those things. But when it comes to nutrition,
neuroscience.
When it comes to nutrition, like, don't say anything if you don't know it. Like, it's just because you've got this power, you've got this platform. Like, his podcast grew Like, he grew so crazy because, you know, he went on the Rogan, he went on Rich Roll, and he just exploded. And now he's out there potentially harming people because of the advice that he's giving on, hey, we need cholesterol because our brain has cholesterol. Like,
man, I should do a video response to this.
Do it.
Send me which episode it was. It's probably the food one. It's probably one of the ones I have listened to. Yeah, because I keep getting text messages about it. It's like, oh man, it's from what I gather is like Stanford neuroscientist who walked into a CrossFit gym to get all of his nutrition.
So what
advice.
Do you eat? Like,
yeah, he probably thinks eggs don't harm you. He probably is a cholesterol denier. Probably all these things, which hasn't looked closely, but who knows? Maybe if he's prone to the research, he might change his mind as he learns more. But yeah, I think maybe I'll do a video this week on it. Who knows?
Do it.
I'll have to check it out.
Do it.
He's just audio though. He's not video. So it's less
video.
Interesting for you.
His video.
Oh, he has video too.
All of his. Well,
oh, okay.
From my
I've only listened
knowledge.
On Spotify.
Yeah, I've seen his YouTube videos because he has like a really nice voice, and I'm like, I want to put a face to his voice. But like, it's so funny when I'm looking at plant-based evidence and coming from like what we were kind of evolved to do. When I'm first having that conversation with someone, like, why would you even want to go plant-based? Like, what benefits do you have? I personally usually stick to the tribe mentality because that's what the Rogans of the world love. They love looking at the Inuit specifically, and they love looking at these tribes. I'm like, well, they have 80 to 100 grams of fiber a day. Can you just explain to me how you consume that much fiber on an animal-centric diet? And that's usually where I take the conversation. When you're first having that conversation with someone, what angle do you usually take?
So totally depends on the person. Totally depends on what questions they're asking, what concerns they have, and on and on and on. And a lot of times that conversation happens in a place where there's other people who don't want to hear anything about it. And so I'm kind of like, I kind of accidentally end up gauging more curiosity because I'll be talking and they'll be like, hey, like, why are you vegan because of this? Or like, what happens with like dairy and what's bad about dairy? And I'll just be like, does everybody here actually want to hear about what's bad about dairy? And then they'll kind of be like, no, but then the other person will get super curious. I'll be like, now I need to know what's bad about dairy. It's just funny, those dynamics. But yeah, and in terms of what I actually, to answer your question, what I actually tell people about, usually I just try to find the point that they're concerned about and then hit it, because there's pretty much a good argument for any concern. It's like, they're concerned about health stuff. It's obviously an argument I make all the time. It's concerned about environmental stuff and on and on and on. It's rare to find the people who are straight up just concerned about animals, but it's good. Like, they're probably already vegan or vegetarian at least. So I don't have like any trick. It was like, here's the thing I tell everybody so that they go more vegan. Usually my goal is to just walk away with them really knowing that they don't eat animal protein, of like, you know, slamming home that there's Olympic weightlifter people that are vegan, IFBB pros that are vegan since birth, and on and on. And just how essential, a lot of people just don't know how essential amino acids work or how much the body really requires in terms of grams of protein a day. And it's like, if you're, you know, if you can just get a few points in on along those lines, then you're at least making some headway. And then they can open their mind to be like, oh, I guess I don't need to eat that animal protein every day. Maybe like, we'll try meatless meals and stuff like that.
I really like that path. And I think it's one of the points that you raised on your happy veganursary, 10 years.
Oh, yeah.
That's awesome.
Nice. 10 years, yeah.
I think it was one of your points of not trying to be, I guess, the perfect vegan. And then from that, I would stem, well, when I first went vegan and I'm like, I got to be a bloody weightlifter. I got to be a scientist. I got to be an environmentalist. I got to be a philosopher. And you kind of try to put on all these hats and, you
That's
know, it
funny.
Starts getting yeah. heavy and your neck's like, just can't take it. And I think what's really cool is you've got, you know, Mike the Vegan, who's an expert opinion for a lot of people, and even you yourself outsource your conversations to athletes who either relate to that person or have done something that you haven't. So you don't have to be an Olympic weightlifter as well. And I think that's really important, because I feel like when it comes to sustainability, which is what we talk about a lot, your mental health also plays a part in that. And if you're trying to be everything, veganism is not going to be sustainable. And then sooner or later, Mike the Vegan's going to make a video about you because you've gone ex-vegan because there's too much pressure.
That's the fear. Is that you're going to get the Mike the Vegan? No, thankfully, I haven't had that many of those I've needed to make lately. I mean, it's basically been Miley Cyrus and like the other people that quit were like really like one or two really small YouTubers quit over like the last year-ish, not full year, but you know what I mean? So that's pretty good. But yeah,
are you sick of making those videos? I guess I just look at myself
as a public. Oh yeah. Sometimes it can get really frustrating making those videos. It was like, once a bunch of people requested, I'm like, I guess I need to do this again. But then I kind of get in the swing of it and it's just, you know, I like making YouTube videos. So it gets easy to do. But yeah, I would say, obviously I'm limited in my expertise. I'm not a doctor, just a public health, master's of public health student. So it's, for me, it's just public health messaging and then letting other people do the other work. Like they do the studies and, you know, I interview the doctors. Like I try to interview doctors pretty often. And that's just where I land. Yeah. Even though I also do have a sustainability, a bachelor's of science in sustainability too, but that's, you know, so like I'm a little bit like, I'm not trying to claim to be the authority, but that's why I link every claim in the description, because it's not about a person's, you know, person's authority for me. Cause every time there's somebody who seems to be an authority, they start just making claims without backing it at all. Mm. Cause it takes work to back those claims.
It does.
And so it can get bad real fast when people start being the expert or being the authority, I should say.
If they get that percentage wrong and they link it, they lose all their, I guess, reputation. And that's the fear.
People can make mistakes. That's fine. It's just that, you know, people start mixing their speculation with, like, you know, they start putting that on the same level as like peer-reviewed randomized controlled trials. Like we just got to stay away from that.
So you get your video ideas from the comment section usually?
Yeah, or just like, well, scan the internet. Like, what is the most, you know, what's going on with the recent studies on PubMed with vegan stuff? Like, what are we seeing? Or I'll type in vegan on the news tab at Google and like see what's going on. Or I will do a scan of YouTube, which is again how I found out that What I've Learned video is still, or has like 3.5 million views. Or I'll look at the comments, messages, on and on. So
I don't want to make you pick a favorite child, but what's your favorite video you reckon you've made?
I mean, I'm most proud of my How Your Body Transforms to Vegan Diets because that's the most views. But what would my favorite video ever be? I have favorites for different reasons. Like I have the video that is one of my favorite that I think is the only video I've ever taken down, which was like the vegan music video, Veganism is Extreme, which is ridiculous.
Did you say you had to take that down?
I took it down on purpose because we also had like me and like my partner dancing in like skimpy clothes, which is funny at the time, but like later on, it just like, it's like, maybe we just don't want this on the internet. Like, and it was just like really cringe. It was like some really cringe stuff too, like making fun of people like sucking on cow teats and stuff. And it's just like, maybe I should take that down.
Right.
So that was like one of my, that was a fun one to make, even though you can't see it. I've had fun making some of my response videos. Like I think I really like my like what the health debunked response video was one, like, cause that was one I witnessed. They had like a public viewing in Canada of it where I was there. And I was like, it was weird watching my own video with people, but I was watching that. I was like, oh, this is actually like more entertaining than my other video. So like, I should try to make more videos like this where I'm just responding and joking around and having a good time. So those are, I don't know, those are always my favorite videos, is the response video. And way more people watch the response videos. They're just like, doing too many response videos can get a little toxic. And then,
yeah, of course,
they're a lot of work, like the clipping, like even just like getting little clips of what you're responding to. I still do that like pretty often, but to go full response video on like a major topic can be a lot of work. And there hasn't been something in the last like few weeks that's been worth responding. Although that Neil deGrasse Tyson video keeps getting more views. It was when I started vegan, it was one of the top video. I guess it was like 150,000. Like,
well, about him basically not like saying I'm not vegan anymore. That one,
No, Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Oh, the animal sentience.
Don't worry about it.
For some reason, I thought, what's that? What is that? Mike Tyson, I thought. I'm like, oh.
Oh, Mike Tyson. You're like, oh, no. Yeah, basically Neil deGrasse Tyson talking about, basically justifying why he eats animals with the worst arguments ever and so like trying cringe. To tie them into like scientific points. And it was bad, basically being like, I'm thankful to the animal, so it's okay for me to eat pigs. And like, I don't even care if some animal is smarter than the other because I value all life equally, from like a blade of grass to like a freaking dolphin. They're all equal, was like kind of where he was going. So that was frustrating. And so I did a response video. Earthling Ed did a response video. I think maybe Happy Healthy Vegan did. I don't know. A lot of people responded.
Well, it's kind of like, why aren't you eating dogs then if you value all things the same? Yep. Like, it's just, it's such a, I mean, I thank him for giving such an obvious and blatant argument. Like, of all people, yeah, he should be the one saying something intelligent to make you think, oh, wait, maybe that is a spin that we need to take and something that might take a bit of effort to be debunked. And instead, to debunk that, it's just like, are you serious?
That is, yeah, I know. It is, yeah, it is frustrating to see that. In fact, a lot of times, like I say, people who are really intelligent end up just adding a few extra hurdles in their ethical decisions, you know, more ethical gymnastics. They're like, they need just like a couple more reasons, but they're still as logically invalid. There's just more of them, so they can like keep doing what they're doing. I don't know. Like, they feel like they've thought about it, even though they haven't properly thought about it. Yeah.
I agree. I mean, Neil deGrasse Tyson clearly trying to find a problem with veganism. Do you have a problem with veganism? Like, do you think there's some sort of logical fallacy or something that is just like, it doesn't sit right with you?
I don't see there's a problem. I think, especially depending on the definition you have, I mean, the vegan society definition of just like basically trying to be the best you can in terms of minimizing suffering, I don't think you can really find a problem with that. Maybe the biggest problem with modern vegans is that they will sometimes just draw the line of animals. Like the fact that we have like straight up racist people, like white supremacist vegans, who will then claim that to have like an ethical reason for being vegan, like that to me is like, that's just doesn't make sense, especially because I view humans as animals. So that's where you can kind of interpret things differently. So I guess I view myself as what you call like a total liberationist. So for me, it's about like the total liberation of all living beings as much as is practically possible or possible. Mm-hmm. Because you can get an issue where you're liberating people who then cause suffering of others. People, you know, like there can be some issues with that, or like, do you let the tribes in the Arctic Circle or whatever club seals? Like, what do you do about these ethical dilemmas? But you know, minimize suffering—that's the goal. Human animal or non-human animal—that's kind of where I land. And then veganism is almost like an umbrella that exists underneath that for me, which is something I actually probably should talk about in a video.
Yeah, because that's a really gray area. Like, it's more than, hey, I'm not a vegan because I drive a car and hence I kill insects on the road. It's more like your decisions. It's like the whole principle of every action has an equal and opposite reaction. And when it comes to your decisions, you have all the control in the world. But when you're looking at that example of tribes, it's like, man, I don't want to impede on their culture because they don't drive a car. They don't do all these things that maybe they don't use plastic. Like, that's something that we use as a society, but then they do this horrific thing. And it's like, are you asking them to be perfect? Like,
yeah,
you have to.
Yeah. What do you let slide? What do you not let slide? How much control do you try to have over other people in terms of, you know, you're trying to minimize harm. You know, if you have, I mean, it becomes a trolley problem where you have to switch a lever to see, you know, which lane to go in and how much damage each one does. And because you could get really utilitarianism in terms of just trying to reduce the amount of suffering, and you could conclude that like most humans and all farm animals should just be killed, you know. Like, there's a lot of ethical issues there, so that, I mean, it becomes a more complicated discussion. But I think I should probably get back to work in a couple of minutes.
All right, let's do this. Let's wrap this up.
It's been about an hour, huh?
Yeah, so it's been just over.
Had a good solid one.
Let's do it. I'll finish up with a few things. Firstly, first question is, how do you define health and being healthy?
Ooh, I feel like health for me is just, you know, the convergence of a few things of, you know, like good diet, good exercise, rest, and being mentally healthy if you can, as much as you can. Obviously that's a privilege. That's health. That, I mean, those are, you know, major points of health for me.
I love it.
yeah, I don't know.
And then I want to leave you with a bigger one, actually, because that wasn't good enough. No, I'm joking. look, we talked about a lot, and everything we talked about can split onto trees, like virtually forever.
Yeah.
Do you have any words of wisdom to leave us in the Plant Paradigm community that could be related to what we talked about today, or could be something completely different that you've been thinking about over the past days, weeks, months, or years? I'm going to leave the platform all to you.
Man, especially if it's a plant related audience. That's a hard one. I will say, I mean, the thing that's on my mind right now is like, please still realize that there's still a pandemic going on. Like, it feels like it's kind of over, but it's really not. And if enough people make stupid decisions right now, like, it's going to be Delta and Gamma for the next year and a half. And it's like, just freaking, you know, wear a mask around people. And I'm vaccinated, so that's a whole nother topic. But I believe that people need to get vaccinated, or we're just going to keep basically perpetually doing this, or we're going to see more people, you know, go kaput, you know, and continue to have this pandemic. It's not a fun point to make, but it's a point I feel like I do need to make. And then for, you know, for vegans, it's like, let's not get too caught up about where it's from. It's from animals. Most viruses are from animals. Let's stop, you know, harming animals, but we still need to prevent that human transmission, to prevent the creation of new strains, and on and on and on. And the viruses and pandemics, something I can talk about for a whole nother hour. But other than that, on a more positive note, I think it's just good to take the opportunity to work on yourself as well. I know people say that a lot, but it's like, you know, do the thing that you probably have been putting off during the pandemic that you feel like you should have done. I feel like if you want the pandemic to be over, then you should have at least done the self-improvement thing that you thought you would do during the pandemic. So if you're at least going to pretend it's over, then you should, you know, do whatever you can to improve yourself.
If you were worried,
it's all about self-improvement.
If you were worried about pissing people off about your cardiovascular approach to reversing heart disease, you did enough with the vaccine. Don't worry about that, man.
Yeah, I know. Piss people off. But I mean, just hearing, you know, I was just listening to this woman talking about how people who are anti-vax are like literally begging to be vaccinated on the spot as they're dying of COVID. And it's like, it's too late. You just have to say, you know, it's like, that's, you know, I can't do anything for you. And it's just a matter of like education, in the sense that like, if people were to be put directly in the hospital where they can't go and witness everything that's happening, witness what these healthcare professionals are listening or witnessing, like the pandemic would be over if like everybody had that experiment. If it was just like experience, if it was just downloaded to your brain, everyone would just be freaking super careful for the 4 weeks. That's the funny part to me, is like, if everybody was just really chill for 4 weeks and did a proper lockdown instead of this weird like in and out, yes, you need masks, no, you don't need masks, blah, 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 it would just be pretty much gone. I mean, yeah, I might bounce from country to country, but in order to do that, you basically need a totalitarian dictatorship to do that across the world and eradicate the virus. But it's just funny, very few people end up having it for longer than like 4 weeks or getting it. And then anyway, I'm rambling now. That was totally past everything that you were asking. You're like, just give us a nice little ending note. And I'm like,
yeah, let's just go. and look, just in the hopes that your laptop doesn't crash before this finishes. I do love to finish all my episodes with a thank you. Obviously, I'd been watching you for years on the good old fashioned YouTubes.com. And, you know, thank you for all the time that you put out to produce videos that in turn help us facilitate conversations with other people around the world that at the end of the day really helps address this looming shadow of a huge issue that is climate change. Animal abuse, a rupt on human rights, like it touches on a lot of these issues, and you're helping a lot of people, including myself and the community, have a platform in which we can get information that is unbiased and agenda free so that we can make the most educated decisions possible to both better our lives, the people around us, our loved ones, making sure that we can, like in your 4 points, live a happy life. So I appreciate that you put time out of your days, your weeks, and you know, it's been years now doing the YouTube. So I appreciate mm-hmm. that. And I also thank you for coming on, sparing some time in between painting cabinets to,
yeah. to have thanks, this yeah, conversation. Thanks so much for having me. Thanks for the kind words. And I guess I would add to the health point, a healthy environment. If you are so privileged to create one or be in one, that's also a major part of health. Major, major part of health. Can't stress that enough. And so, yeah, thanks for having me. I love the good conversation. Keep in touch. Send me that Huberman
I will
clip
do.
So I can respond to it.
Hi there. Welcome to the end of the episode. Thank you so much for listening and or watching the whole way through. I truly enjoyed this conversation with Mike. His knowledge is definitely something that is a huge resource and a huge win for the plant-based community. His commitment to reading the right science and having an evidence-based approach pretty much just means you should head over to YouTube and subscribe to him. The amount of knowledge I've gotten for this show from his channel is amazing. And the fact that he does link everything in the show notes is incredibly important. And that's exactly why I do too. So when we're looking at Instagram at plant.paradigm, I'm always talking about the resources. And Mike was an influence in that. We can't be talking these stats and figures and percentages without backing up our claims. Otherwise, we're no better than the doctors and the pseudoscience mongers that do love doing that without any backing. And we want to make sure that we have an evidence-based approach because there's so much misinformation. So thank you to Mike for not helping spread that misinformation, but also coming on and having this conversation. I'll leave all the ways to connect with him in the show notes below, and of course, ways to connect with us as well. If you did enjoy the show, share it to a friend, family member, or a colleague. I know Mike is a huge influence for a lot of you guys, so share it to his fans. If you know someone who listens to Mike, I'm sure that this will be a great resource to send them. But that is all from me today. Stay happy, eat plants, peace.